Good morning, welcome. Please stand and join me for We Sing of Golden Mornings, number 44. We sing of golden mornings, we sing of sparkling seas, of prairies, valleys, mountains, and stately forest trees. We sing of flashing sunshine and life bestowing rain, of birds among the branches, and springtime come again. We sing the heart courageous, the youthful eager mind. We sing of hopes undaunted, of friendly ways and kind. We sing the roses waiting beneath the deep piled snows. We sing the earth's great splendor, whose beauty round us grows.
I'm Karen Dorn Steele, today's lay leader, and I welcome you to the Unitarian Universalist Church of Spokane with greetings to our online visitors from around the United States and Canada. Whether you're here in our sanctuary today or watching from afar, it is here that we join to create a nourishing religious home with a mission to champion justice, diversity, and environmental stewardship in the wider world, or as we say more concisely, to create community, find meaning, and work for justice or live justly. Now please take a moment to greet one another. We now turn from our informal greetings to formally begin our services by lighting our chalice, the symbol of Unitarian Universalism, of our unity and solidarity, of our openness and inclusion, of our community and individuality. May this small flame be our offering of warmth to those who are cold and alone, and a light to those in darkness. May it be a flame that ignites justice in our world and a beacon of hope to those in need. And may it reflect at least a spark of truth wherever truth has been lost, and cast a healthy shadow of doubt where it has been found. I begin today with an announcement. Next Sunday, March 3rd, we'll celebrate, finally in person, our 33-year relationship with our partner church in Felsorakos, Romania. A Hungarian lunch will be served at 12:30 following the second service. Both pork and vegetarian goulash will be offered, bread and desserts for suggested donations of $5 to $10. And you'll also have a chance to win souvenirs from Felsorakos brought back by UUCS visitors. The raffle tickets are $1 each, or 6 for $5, and they'll be on sale next week. Now, it's my pleasure to introduce Jacob Johns, a member of our congregation and today's speaker. Jacob has had a dramatic and painful 6 months. Last September, he was shot by a man wearing a MAGA hat at a prayer gathering in Española, Mexico, New Mexico, where a crowd was celebrating a city decision to pause the reinstallation of a statue of a controversial Spanish conquistador that had been removed amid the George Floyd protests in June 2020. As the shooter charged an altar erected on the vacant statue's pedestal, Jacob stood in the way. The bullet tore into Jacob's stomach, spleen, liver, and diaphragm, threatening his life. He recently told a Spokesman Review reporter that his heart stopped after he was shot, and in his liminal state, he traveled to the spirit world to beg a council of elders to let him return to life on earth. "I was told that it would be difficult, that I had to work harder," he told reporter James Hamblin. After 5 weeks in the hospital and more recuperation at home in Spokane, he recovered enough to lead an indigenous delegation in January to COP28 in Dubai, the United Nations annual climate conference. Johns, who is Hopi and Akimil Otham, was incarcerated as a young man, but changed his life after prison. He's already a veteran of the climate fight. He protested the Dakota Access Pipeline in 2016 at Standing Rock, where excavations disrupted an ancient burial ground and also threatened groundwater. He was pepper sprayed and set upon by guard dogs at Standing Rock. At a climate conference in Egypt in 2022, he interrupted a speech by President Joe Biden with a war cry while raising a banner. He had to sign paperwork saying he wouldn't repeat such a protest again. When Jacob was shot, he was deep in planning for the first Indigenous Wisdom Keepers delegation to attend a climate conference. The 15-member group includes Native leaders representing the world's bioregions. Their goal is to teach their wisdom and influence the climate conversation. Jacob is now preparing for the next conference at the end of this year in Azerbaijan. He attends because these are the places where fateful climate decisions are made, and he, in the words of Alexander Hamilton, wants a seat at the table. Let's welcome Jacob to our sanctuary.
Stand and join me for our next hymn, number 1007, "There's a River Flowing in My Soul."
There's a river flowing in my soul. Somebody there.
We gather as a congregation, there are always those in our hearts and minds that we want to wrap in our love and care, including the family of Moritz Kundig, a prominent Spokane architect and UU member since the 1950s, who died on February 10th at age 98. We also mourn the continuing gun violence in our country that has touched Jacob Johns recently and so many others, plus the continued suffering in Ukraine and Gaza. Let us share a moment in silence, embracing others who are here in our hearts, those named aloud and those remembered in the silence we hold in our community of compassion. It is now time for our offering, which sustains the life of this community, both our social justice work and our ministerial work. Please consider giving today. Thank you.
Good morning. Is this on? Yes. In honor of our wonderful guest, speaker, and member of the church, too, Jacob, I'd like to have people sing the song Pete Seeger made it huge with his lyrics, Jacob's Ladder. And you can sing with me if you would kindly do so. It goes like this. You don't know. We are climbing Jacob's ladder. We are climbing Jacob's ladder.
We are climbing. sisters all.
Thank you.
I almost forgot. It's time for all ages. Where are you, kids? Kids, kids, kids. Come over here. There'll be a story for you. Yeah. Yeah, come on, come on. I see somebody familiar. Yes, you'll be sitting somewhere on the front. Okay. Okay. So, I see Arthur. Yeah. Max, question for you. Do you think you are smarter and stronger than a small animal like a 15-pound dog? A 15-pound dog, you see, not big. Maybe, yeah. In fact, there is a small animal in the world that is 3 times stronger than a human. Any guesses? Yeah. Maybe? Any more guesses? No? No guesses? Okay, here's a tip for you. This unusual creature lives in Amazon rainforest. Its movements are extremely slow, and it has a locking mechanism that allows the animal to sleep while hanging from a tree branch. Sloth, you're so good. Yeah. All right. Sloths are amazing animals. It is hard to imagine a sloth can starve to death on a full stomach. Do you know why? If it gets too cold, then special microbes living in its stomach die, and the animal can no longer digest the food it has eaten. Sloths have a reputation of being lazy creatures and sleep all day. They can remain motionless for 15 or more hours because they need to conserve their energy and avoid being detected by predators. So here's an episode from a book written by Eric Carle called Slowly, Slowly, Slowly. The story goes like this. 2 monkeys and a jaguar were playing in the forest when they saw a sloth on a branch of a tree. The sloth was slowly opening its mouth while chewing on a leaf. "Why are you so slow?" asked the monkeys. Silence. No answer. "Why are you so boring?" asked the jaguar. Still, not a single word from the sloth. It was just finishing chewing the leaf. After a while, the sloth turned its head very, very slowly and crawled down the branch. You know, sloths cannot see in the bright daylight, but they have a phenomenal sense of smell. Evidently, the sloth needed to smell the company down near the tree. "Why are you so quiet?" the monkeys went on asking the sloth. "He must be very lazy," assumed the jaguar. The sloth thought and thought and thought. Finally, it replied, "Listen, guys, it's true that I'm slow and quiet and boring, and I'm also sluggish and calm and mellow and relaxed, but I am not lazy." Then the sloth yawned and fell asleep. Sometimes we may assume that somebody is too slow, too sloppy, or maybe lazy just because they are not acting like we do. But even if we look alike, we are all different. And maybe we should be more curious and learn from these differences, huh? What do you think? Let's sing the kids out. As we prepare for meditation, I invite you to relax, breathe deeply, and reflect on words by Rumi, which are going to be delivered by Jacob's friend, Bonnie Roberts. Bonnie is a climate activist as well as Jacob's friend.
Thank you. Sorrow prepares us for joy. It violently sweeps everything out of our house so that new joy can find space to enter. It shakes the yellow leaves from the bough of your heart so that fresh green leaves can grow in their place. It pulls up the rotten roots so that new roots hidden beneath have room to grow. Whatever sorrow shakes from your heart, far better things will take their place.
Good morning, everybody. A quick hop from Westminster to the backcountry of Maine many decades ago. There was wind in the pines, the rivers ran wild. We gathered round the campfire when I was a child. Eyes drifted skyward, faces all aglow. People came together long, long ago.
as fast as the tide will allow. Our tar sides are splintering. Where should we go? Past wildfires and hurricanes and the earthquake below. Where we're going, strong voice of protest has been steadily growing. We protest injustice wherever it comes, from carbon emissions or the barrel of a gun. Like the bear in a cave, above a rolling stream, we're waking up hungry from a bad summer dream, looking for fresh water, looking for pure air. Carry on with 7 generations in mind of those who've passed and the ones still to come. Our differences are mostly the story we're in, not language or culture or the color of skin. But unless we unite, black, brown, and white, it's Armageddon. The planet, keep a cool mind. The world will turn green again. There'll be wind in the pine. Come round the campfire in summertime. Let's have peace in the valley.
Cool. Thank you so much for that. That was amazing. I liked the part about Jacob's ladder. And Bonnie, thank you once again for coming up here. I asked Bonnie to come first thing this morning. I said, "Come, will you come in and read this poem for me?" And she agreed. So thank you, Bonnie. Thank you. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Jacob Johns. I am a community supported organizer based here in Spokane. I use all human pronouns, and I have been doing community supported organizing for the past 7 years. I have a background in organizing for the Democratic Party. We're organizing single-issue ballot initiatives regionally here in the east side of the state and then across the region of Washington. The community-supported organizing is basically me being as a solo nonprofit group that does intersectional organizing regionally, nationally, and internationally for the past 6 years. The community-supported organizing has allowed me to do a lot of stuff. I started doing community-supported organizing the day after Trump was elected president. I went down and signed up with the Backbone Campaign to switch from organizing for its political action committees associated with the Democratic National Committee to organizing for frontline supply runs to Standing Rock. And a lot of people saw me. I had a week off of work because we were doing so well in our campaign. Everything's going to. They had a week off, paid vacation. I'm gonna go to Maui. Some people are gonna go over here. You know, they're doing all these different things. And I went to North Dakota. Nobody heard of it at that time. You know, everybody's like, "Why are you going to North Dakota?" You know, trying to explain it to them. But during that time, a week there was an altercation that happened that Democracy Now! Was there, and they had let dogs loose on the protesters who were trying to prevent a pipeline to go through a graveyard. 100 years ago, the American government killed a bunch of women and children from the Ocheti Sequin, and so where these people fell, they buried them on the spot, and it just so happened that these graves were in the path of this proposed pipeline that they were trying to install. And so we went out there and tried to stop them. They let the dogs loose on us, pepper spray, all the things. And the video went viral and it went all over the place. And so I used that moment of fame to raise some funds to bring supplies back to the camp there at Standing Rock, which started a series of months and months of ongoing support for the front lines and bringing people. I think at one point we brought 35 people from Spokane to come and do direct action, standing on the line, which is an amazing thing for Spokane to stand up in that way. I do a lot of this community support organizing thinking about my daughter. My daughter is now 11 years old, and she's almost as tall as me, which sucks. It's not really saying a whole lot. I'm not that tall of a guy. But you can see her down here. This is a painting of her back when she was little. She used to be so sweet when she wasn't sassy. And she fell asleep one day with her fists up in the air, and I was like, right on, right on. So I do a lot of other things to help pay the bills besides doing community-supported organizing for social justice projects and environmental causes doesn't really give you a whole lot of fun. So I do a lot of portrait work and other artistic endeavors to help pay the bills and supplement my income for me and my daughter. It's been an ongoing thing for the past 7 years, which has brought me into a wide variety of projects. And if you've been following me for the past couple of years, it's an ongoing thing that never ends. One of the things I wanted to mention before I get started is that a couple of years ago, this congregation actually had a hand in shifting systematic change by doing some direct action here out on the street. For those of you who remember that George Wright was named the fort was named after him, and they named the street after him, and he did horrible things to the first people of this land. And we had done direct actions in the street where we had brought in tribal members from all the affected tribes to give oral testimony to what happened to their people when the Americans came here to this land. And for them to have a street named after this person was like having a street named after Hitler, and we had to do something. We worked diligently along with a bunch of other community groups to shift the name from Fort George Wright, or from George Wright to Wistock's Way. And so, and it was ongoing. You know, I'm not from here. I'm a transplant. I'm originally from Phoenix, Arizona. Mesa, if you're lucky, which is not the best place. I see somebody from AZ in the back. There's another one. Watch her. But the we changed the name. And, you know, after this has been a couple of years, we had spent some time convincing the city to give us the old signs. And so we have arranged for a group of artists to come together and create a statue, a sculpture, out of these signs to, as an homage to what took place, for us to move past the atrocities that we have to endure from the past, but also to move past that and create something new out of that. So we are actually selling these jerseys, this one that I have on right now. You can see I'm rocking the own brand. It says Land Back on the front. And then on the back, we stand in solidarity with our Black brothers and sisters in the South who are seeking reparations from slavery. We are raising funds, $100 or more gets you one of these sweet jerseys, and you can talk to me after the service about how to contribute. 100% of the profits are going to go back to the project. We need about $5,000 to $7,000 to pay for just the products itself to create the statue. We're anticipating it being 10 to 12 feet made out of the signs from George Wright. As we talk about, you know, this creation of something new out of the horrible things that we've had to endure, I think it's a great segue into moving into this work. You know, we can look back at these protests and these fights that we've had domestically about, you know, fighting infrastructure that is going to kill us, or ultimately signing, you know, us up for death. And we as Americans, you know, come together when it's necessary to fight, like the Dakota Access Pipeline was a big one, Line 3, Line 5, the Mountain Valley Pipeline, where we fight these infrastructures, we fight these systems that are, you know, in control of corporations that wish us harm. And that itself is defeating. We have, you know, so much opposition over the years to just pass the smallest piece of legislature, one smallest piece of progressive climate policy, one smallest piece of what we truly see as a future that is healthy, just, and livable. And, you know, as we have been dealt defeating blow after defeating blow, it's important for us to remember that as these systems of oppression start to become obsolete, that we must institute new systems that will make the older systems completely non-existent. There's no need for these systems of oppression if we have moved together in a wonderful, beautiful way forward. So as these different places of working regionally and working nationally, I was brought into the U.S. Climate Action Network, which is, you know, a big coalition of NGOs, green NGOs, that are working on climate issues, and more importantly, they wanted to bring in a social justice aspect to that. And as a solo nonprofit group, as one person trying to do this work all the time, it was very, very important for me to amplify my voice. So as joining the network, I was able to get into spaces where the head of Greenpeace were sitting at the table, the head of the Sierra Club, the 350. I mean, these big, large national NGOs were working together and trying to put their minds together to create something beautiful. So they invited me to come into these spaces. And, you know, working nationally on national campaigns and coming up with the development of different things, it was important for me to try to step outside of the space that we are all faced with domestically. Trying to pass things regionally and federally, it's you know, almost impossible. It's like pulling teeth. And even though there's a vast majority of us who want to think progressively into these spaces, it's important for us to utilize our voices, especially speaking truth to power. And so there's nothing better than focusing on the world by focusing on the world, right? It's kind of this space where we understand that, you know, the science has told us that we have reached tipping points. We have gone past these moments in time that we could have prevented. The Paris Accord is to prevent the planet, well, it was originally intended to prevent the countries from lowering their emissions below 1.5 degrees total temperature rise in Celsius before there was impending climate collapse happening all around the world. And we officially last summer reached 1.5 degrees in global temperature rise. And, you know, we are being fed all these dystopian things for the longest of times, that the end of the world is near, that we must repent, you know, all the different things that happen that when we focus on the end. And I'm here to say that as the old world dies, a new one is created. And we must shift our thought from the end of times to the beginning of times, that we must shift our focus into the creative aspects that we have within ourselves to develop something new, to develop something that we can submit that supersedes the old impending or the old outdated ways of living. And so as somebody who does a lot of frontline direct action, it was important. I was wanting to educate people on the things that happen at the UNFCCC. A lot of us domestically don't have the knowledge or the focus from our media to talk about what's happening in these global negotiation tables. The UN COP is basically the negotiating tables for signatories underneath the climate accords. So it's the umbrella substructure of the United Nations framework for discussing these negotiations. And so each country who signs onto it comes to negotiate those climate accords at these different places. We had just stepped out of the 28th year, which was in Dubai. We are now focusing on the 29th, right? This is what this is where the countries come. So it's not uncommon for you as a civil society, civil person to be walking down the road and, you know, see John Kerry walk past by you, you know, Deb Haaland will walk past you, President of Africa will, you know, all these different things, all these different places will be, this is what the space is for. It's for interacting with heads of state in these civil spaces. This is what the COP is meant for. And so we were talking about a little bit about doing direct actions. A couple years ago, I was kicked out of Egypt. I was kicked out of the COP for interrupting President Biden's speech. It's, you know, important, I think, when we have a Democratic president who is doing zero things but giving lip service to these corporations who are trying to work in partnership with our government to create schemes that do nothing to solve the climate crisis. It's important for us to stand up and use our voice, especially as American citizens. You know, we come into these spaces thinking that the rest of the world has free speech and that, you know, we are obligated and, more importantly, focused on using our voice in a way that will have and demand justice. But, you know, the truth is that as one person, there's only so many things that we can do. And so I was walking around Glasgow, I think, about 3 years ago, and I was filming for folks, interviewing them, trying to create a video that explained what the intricacies of how things play out at the UN COP. And I was interviewing this guy. He looked amazing. He's like this beautiful flower of a human being. He's so colorful, and he was saying all these profound things. And I was like, yes, yes. I wasn't really hearing it, but I was just feeling the vibe of it. You know, like, oh man, this is going to be great. It's going to be like a little cherry on top of this video explaining. And I got home and I turned on the video, and I forgot to turn the microphone on. Whatever he had said had gone to the ether, but like it was a vibe. Like it was so great. I wish I had that sound clip to go with it to really convey this to you. But you know, years went by, and we exchanged information. And I had spent some time in prison when I was 19. I went to prison for assaulting a police officer with a deadly weapon, and I spent the next 8 years in maximum security prison. And when you're locked up like that, you don't really have a whole lot of things to do, right? Like, you work out, you get in a fight, or you can meditate. So I chose meditation, which was really kind of annoying. It was a process. As soon as you wake up, I would wake up, I would sit on the floor and I meditate for 1 or 2 hours a day. And, you know, after time, I got out, years went by, but it started happening again where I would be woken up and it's 3 o'clock in the morning and I'm trying to sleep, right? But it's 3:30 in the morning, but it kept happening as a repetition. So I took it as a sign that the universe was trying to tell me something. So I would sit on the floor and I would just meditate and I would do all these different practices. One of the practices that we do traditionally is to breathe light for the world. It's this practice of us sitting facing the sun, and as the sun rises, imagine breathing in the light and filling your body up. And as you exhale, you blow out all of the darkness that is within your body that's contained inside. So it's not just the darkness, but the stress and the worry and all the things that we have to endure as human beings living in this capitalistic society. We blow that out and we embrace the divine light from source, until our body is completely filled up with light, and then we can continue to go on. But there's also another level to that where you can imagine yourself being fully full of light and then having your body dissolve till you are just one sphere of consciousness. And as that one sphere of consciousness, you can feel the top of your head become the North Pole and the base of your spine become the South Pole. And now, instead of breathing light for yourself, you breathe light for the entire planet. And so as sitting there doing this practice that we do at 3:30 in the morning in my underwear on the living room floor, I got a vision that I needed to go to different places. As the earth, I could feel that there was like a belt or a grid or some sort of line, something around that needed to be connected, like a belt was undone and it needed to be tied up, and find other groups of people who would be willing to participate in breathing in the light for the world. And I got an email 4 hours later from the man who I forgot to record, saying, hey, will you join a group of us that travel to sacred places around the planet to pray for humanity? And I said, yeah. I was told you guys were coming, right? Like, oh, freaking out. And the idea is that there is a system of energy grids that intersect at different places around the planet. You know, like there's Mount Shasta, Great Pyramid of Giza, Stonehenge, all these different places are spots where they intersect in this ley lines. And these ley lines are supposed to amplify prayers and messages and amplify some of the Earth's energies with whatever is mixed in that space. And so I went down and traveled with them. I went to Mount Shasta, went to the Azores Islands. We went to Giza, the Great Pyramid of Giza last year, or 2 years ago when we were in Egypt. And then we went to China, went to Tibet, went to Australia, went down to New Zealand. We went to Greenland to do ceremony for the North Pole. We went all over the place. They filmed it in a documentary called Transformations, which will be out this year. But, you know, as we come into these spaces and I'm interacting with these people who travel around the world just to pray, just to hold ceremony together, was transformative. I mean, I was walking out on the big ice shelf in Greenland with the Inuit elders to do ceremony for the North Pole. Pretty intense. That water was fantastic, by the way. But, you know, as this shift is happening and all these systems are falling, that we understand that we have to do more than just pray. A group of us in this collective of people, the vast majority were going to be participating in the COP itself, which was taking place in Egypt a couple years ago. So it made sense for the collective to come together and to, you know, do something, since the vast majority of the collective would be in Egypt. And so we got together, spent a week doing ceremony and prayer and sharing, and then we hiked to the top of Mount Sinai to do ceremony at sunrise before COP27 in Egypt. And it was very powerful. It's a very transformative thing to be with all these, you know, these medicine people from all around the world who are coming just to put their hearts and minds together to pray for the future of humanity, especially at these key places that are sacred to so many traditions. And we, I think, as indigenous people, have this urge to connect to the past and to amplify the culture and tradition that is passed down to us. But as a Hopi, you know, we do ceremony for the benefit of humanity. Nothing that we do is for ourselves. It is for the whole of human consciousness. It is for it's the divine plan for us to even be here. This is the whole reason for us to be on this planet. This is why we signed up for life. And as we do our ceremonies with the intention of the benefit of all of humanity and for the future of humanity, it made sense to do that. But also, we can only do so much to pray. Right, I think as you use, we understand that we must take the words of these prophets and use them, but more importantly, comprehend them in our everyday moments of what it is that we are doing, how we approach life, that we can't just pray, that we need to take action. We need to move forward with that consciousness that was given to us by divine prophets or whatever world religions, but we must take that and use it in action. And so it was good for us to come together and to pray and to do all these different things, but it was important for us to take that indigenous wisdom, distill it down, and form it in a way that was concrete, that we could use to advance contemporary climate policy that was logical and that would pull us out of the chaos that is the world right now. We so easily get caught up in emotions. Everything is wrong. Everything is bad. Media is telling us the end is near. All these things. But as the world traditions and the leaders that I've been with, and from my own divine, traditions, I should say, that the world is being created as the old world dies. We're not alone. There is never an end. There is despair is a lie. That there is a new world that is being created simultaneously as the old one passes. And it's important for us to define that future with our present movements and what it is that we're doing to progress society and everything that we've done. So I I said, let's get them together and let's put together some climate policy and go as a delegation to the COP. So we started prepping for Dubai, which is the most expensive city in the world, right? And we had raised some money, had raised some funds. I got some a 3-year grant from the U.S. Climate Action Network to give us $60,000, $20,000 each year. And then we were doing small, you know, donations. We got some money from Patagonia. We're doing all this stuff. And then I came back from the trip, and I went to New Mexico to do the West Coast regional meeting for the U.S. Climate Action Network. And one of the things the network likes to do is support local movement spaces. So I connected with some local organizers who were doing a prayer vigil for a statue that they were trying to re-erect that basically gave an homage to genocide. And so I went out there and spent the night with them in Española, New Mexico. And during the prayer gathering, some agitators showed up with a gun. And they was mainly women and children that were there, which they needed people to be on the line. And so I had agreed. I said, yeah, I'll come out. And during the day after the sunrise ceremony, somebody got on the microphone. It was one of the children's mothers, and they asked for me to come, or they asked for the children to come into the middle in a very scared sensation. So all the children started to run into the center, and I ran out to the front, and there an agitator was, and pulled out a gun and shot me in the chest. And I don't know if anybody's been shot in the chest before, but it sucks. Like, it's, would not recommend. The bullet went through my lungs, went through my stomach, went through my pancreas, went through my liver, went through my spleen. They had to remove my spleen. It was a hollow point bullet that just exploded my internal organs. And I died. I died on the helicopter from Santa Fe to Albuquerque. And when you die, I mean, this is—it's everything was, from my experience, frozen in time. And at that moment in time, I had to go before a council of spirits and go over my life, everything that I've done in my life to come up here. All these times that I've overcame obstacles. All these times I set out to do whatever it is I was instructed to do. All these impossible things, and I had achieved them. And I tried to use those moments where I had chosen willpower over selfishness, when I had chosen service to others versus service to self, and brought out these prime examples as a reason why humanity still had a chance of surviving in the face of so much adversity. And I had to beg. In trying to think of time in a linear fashion is impossible because of the infinity that it is on the other side. And I was able to create a new life contract in order to come back. And I don't remember everything. You know, I was out for a while, but I remember that I needed to continue to do the work around uniting the world. And, you know, uniting the world, it sounds so grandiose, but like there are actual steps that we can take in order to create this. You know, a good friend of mine says that we are beyond the tipping point, that we, the time for small steps has passed us, that we must take a giant quantum leap into the future together in a just, equitable way that can propel us into the new world that we so desperately need. And, you know, that itself is something that I took with me. And after I came back and I was in the hospital, it was the worst pain that I've ever had to endure. I still have ongoing medical issues. My last surgery, hopefully, is next week. I still have a drain in my liver. I still, you know, have a lot of damage from the injuries themselves. But I died, and I came back. And one of the reasons that I wanted to share this story with you all is because whatever can be pulled out of the infinite doesn't necessarily have to be dystopian, right? Like we always have a chance to prevent chaos from happening. We have a chance to step back from the ledge, that there is a future that is healthy and just and livable, and it's within reach. It's already been created. It's just up to us to actualize that. It's up to us to turn the light on and to be bright and to illuminate others. It's important for us to continue to work in that way and never give into the thoughts of despair when we think about the future of humanity and, more importantly, the future of this planet. So I was sitting there and I'm pain. I got tubes out of me and I'm leaking and I was just bleeding and all these things. But, you know, I was spiritually and morally obligated to continue to do the work in Dubai. And so 2 weeks after I got out of the hospital, I forced myself to get on a plane and go to Dubai and spend 3 weeks with the 15 delegates from around the world to advance the contemporary climate policy that we had been working on for the past year. I mean, this was a huge undertaking because of the time zones, first off, but also the language barriers. We had one in-person meeting that lasted for 8 hours because we had to translate from English to Spanish to French to Portuguese and back. Right, that's quite the feat. And it was also, like, for those of you who hate meetings, right? Like, at least we weren't on Zoom. But the truth is that we had come together in order to take our prayers and collectively put them together in a way that could be utilized by heads of state to step back from the cliff, step back from the chaos, to walk forward with logic, and more importantly, with the global solidarity that actually needs to happen. And, you know, as we come into these spaces and we're doing all this work, we come in a good way, based in prayer, and the understanding that we are here to broadcast a new light and the new energy that a lot of us are blind to. And it's so easy to get caught up in the negative and in the darkness and in despair. And as a jaded activist, I can go on and on about how everything's a lie and, you know, they just want the money or all the things that happen. But the truth is that we don't have any room to talk about despair when we think about the future of this world. And it is within our reach to create a new system, a new way of living that is just and healthy and equitable. And I think that as we move into this space, it becomes and feels more right. It becomes that which we already know. All we are doing is trying to uplift the internal wisdom that all of us hold by uniting these different traditions in climate policy was a great way for us to utilize all the different perspectives and, more importantly, approach this from a humanistic point of view, that these come from prayers. It's not just one religion. It's no religions in all religion. And more importantly, that we have a choice. We have a choice to step back from the cliff. We have a choice to embrace change, and that we are going in a good way to shift the hearts and minds of world leaders so that we can save our lives and save our children's lives. And I would like to just sit back and take a moment to salute you all for being here this morning. I know it's a lot, everybody getting up, getting out, but this is a great way for us is locally to have an impact on global negotiations. This is a great way for us domestically to have an impact on world negotiations. When we talk about opening up doors to a new world, it's important. You know, in our tradition, we are brought here to bring up and raise the vibration of the entire planet. And this is actively what we're trying to do through logical climate policy that can be adaptable by world leaders at the United Nations. So as the first year has already passed us. I was given a 3-year grant, which I alluded to earlier. This was before I got shot. And the project continues. So this year we are focusing on Azerbaijan. We are moving into creating more a substantial climate policy. We are working with a larger network in order to influence the NDC, which is a nationally determined contribution, basically a summary of how much the Earth is, or how much each country will pollute for the year, and influence those in ways that we can set up bilateral meetings with the negotiating teams, and then generate a country map from each delegate so that we're all advancing the same climate policy and saying the same words globally in an effort to shift the hearts in the way that we need. And I'd like to just stop and say that I want to salute you all once again for being here, for listening to these words. And so more importantly, you know, keep hope alive that the future is unwritten and that it's every choice that we make that is going to contribute to the future that will be. But the future is unwritten.
As we depart today, No, we're not departing yet. You're singing first. You're right. Sorry.
You're fine. Let's sing a song. Stand, please. Join me for Song of the Soul. There's an insert in your order of service if you'd like to follow along or up there. Love of my life, I am crying. I am not dying. I am dancing. Dancing along in the madness. There is no sadness, only a song of the soul. And we'll sing this song. Why don't you sing along? And we will sing for a long, long time. Why don't you sing this song? Why don't you sing along? And we will sing for a long, long time. What do you do for your living? Are you forgiving? Giving shelter? Follow your heart, love will find you. Truth will unbind you. Sing out a song of the soul and we'll sing this song. Why don't you sing along? And we can sing for a long, long time. Why don't you sing this song? Why don't you sing along? And we can sing for a long, long time. Come to your life like a warrior. Nothing will bore you. You can be happy. Let in the light, it will heal you. And you can feel you. Sing out a song of the soul and we'll sing this song. Why don't you sing along? And we can sing for a long, long time. Why don't you sing this song? Why don't you sing along? And we can sing for a long, long time. And we can sing for a long, long time.
I leave you today with the words of climate activist Bill McKibben in his book, Earth. We must step up the fight to keep climate change from getting even more powerfully out of control and to try to protect those people most at risk, who are almost always those who have done the least to cause the problem. Amen. Blessed be Salam and Shalom.
Shalom, Havarim, Shalom.
I rightly